van waar af, van jou website af?
Ek gaan die URL, ek gaan dit nou op Twitter uitstuur en op Google Plus en ek sal hierso ook
presie
vir julle gee.
Gee dit sommer dan stuur ek dan direk dit by die mens opstuur.
Okay, ja.
Kan jy dit op die Instagram webblad sit ook?
Ja, en ek hoop dat hulle dan record vir jou. So hooplik is daar recording want ek kry gewoonlik nie genoeg memory sticks en met 'n kommer en dan die helfte van die ding. Dit werk net beter
die. Nou hooplik record hulle die ding vir jou.
Okay, gee gee vir ons die
Vertel het vir die, wat is Marine, so? To, tel die Marine.
Ja, tel my about it. Ja, wat?
Jy weet ons, jy moest altyd hierdie internet gehad.
Ek onthou dit.
En die rede kom ons gestop het, en ons het te veel technische probleme gehad met die lijn.
Dis goed, ja.
Skype werk baie goed met dit.
Ja.
Solang die ou is denkelijk, die probleem met Leon is, en die ouwens met Brian is omdat hulle bly die swak connecties.
Ek weet.
Dis wat die probleem is. Ek het geen probleem met myne oor als
meer. Ek weet, Leon wat die IT ding is, is nou sy connecties goed is.
Ek gaan nog met op. Maar, as jy nou dink is met, as jy na die lys geluister is, en die aie, weet die
aktore,
men, daar was nie iemand wat die probleem maak. En so wat ek al gedink het is, om een ding te doen einde januari, een big debate. What is new, and where is technology in everything going on? Ons krijg twee ouwens om die inleiding te geven, en dan, maar ek wil het nou begin promoveer, en ek dink ons maak het, is moet het op een weeks aand doen, want zondag aand het een
account,
en die ander dit, en die ander dat, in die week. Want ek wil ook
nie
meer zondag
aand. Nee, ek sien die kans, ek probeer opvang, op een zondag, nee, want ek
zondag aan de vang, ek goed op wat ek behandig moet die aflevering.
Ek steek nie, ek het my werk, en ek het hierdie plek.
Ja.
En ek sê vir jou, ek weet, ek het my al so vastgebrand,
wie denk jy, wanneer ek op die raad is, wie het al die werk gedoen in plek van die voorzitters? Ek was voorzitter eindelijk. En nou weet jy dit. Ek weet nie,
jy moet verstaan, ek doen van hier van die katoos gegeven. Die ouwe stief van my was, ek deel met, goed wat nie, nie, wat ek nie meer moet deel, die verstaan. Maar as ek nie help nie, dan gaan niemand help. Money!
Money, yeah,
he does. Hi there.
Have you decided to come in?
No, he's come to pitch his book. And I haven't got half of them, eh?
Haven't you?
No, give him some replacement.
Ek het nie, ek het nie, ek het nie, goed die keer, ons het het al, ding is, ons het al, ons het al, ons het al,
If you look at it this way, what I've got is, I'll give you two of these, without any of one of these. Then I have one that one. But I've only got one of these.
BUN.
WTF Grant. The different models. This one we don't have to leave. So this is the RL
one. The one is for the VHF, the other one is for the field, the FS class, one is for Max Ross, the other one is Paul.
No, but I mean,
but I'll let them know.
So ultimately, the invoice that I'll send you is for
okay.
So if they correct, well, they haven't already paid, no. I'll send you invoice. So I'm marked it up for him. Okay. So that's the one at 640. It's quite a bit less than that.
Okay.
So that's the best I could.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's yours.
Thank you.
Well, if you've got livestock, you must expect to have dead stock as well. Was getting so itchy about these breakers. eventually resign. Yeah, it's not a labor to resign. Yeah. So pay him off. Cancel the QIF.
I'm a bit concerned about the Hitchhiker. I've tested the last night. They're not as sensitive as they should be.
This guy.
So I've complained to the supplier.
Now they all want to put his face in doubt. Yeah. He's been got out. Wasn't the whole problem.
I've seen a lot of photos and details of all different measurements.
And since then, I can no issue. Very comfortable.
I actually want to send him back.
No issue with that for over a year. Because it's...
This is the second batch from a different
3 kilometers off of the toll road.
So it might be coming from the same factory.
Dedicated to get to it.
So what is the HF
side is not
this guy? Yeah. So,
That's
a big carrot beef.
I would prefer that way. Because 30 centimeters in might be a problem. It's a little bit smaller than the
hydrogen drive to do.
Almost the dongle size.
Take those hills and go north. And you will then those hills run out just before night.
I haven't tested all of them.
I'm right on the end of those hills. Up in the top. Yes, I've got two more holes. particularly strong, but they're strong enough to support the lifestyle of this town. I mean, I've had the place for nearly 10 years, the previous owner, Peter, not walking to pick it. Morning. I'm Dick, B-U-N.
N-E.
I-L-M. Yes, sir. Yeah. Nice to meet you, yeah. That VHF, yeah. Are you here or at the coast? Is it? Are you? To whereabouts on the coast? Uvongo, oh yeah, nice area. Yeah, I had some friends who used to live just at the Margate side of Uvongo. Oh, really? Yeah.
Are you going to rely on that?
No. No. Yes.
When you get there.
Yeah, I mean, years and years ago, I used to live in a man's of Toti.
Yeah, we just play by.
House maintenance was hard work.
Yeah. Now there's some stack houses down there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I ripped some properties, I don't know. I wouldn't go out there back door.
No, really?
The jungle though.
Oh, really? Yeah.
I've lost a chap over my house. Have you ever been out the back door? He said, no. There might be snakes or whatever.
So you go to the end of the month. Have you sold up here? In
no,
the south?
Sold, yeah.
Sold, yeah.
I had to go up
now. Well,
very long.
Nobody's got the money.
The area's not so good.
Oh, really?
I said, well,
yeah.
They get government permanent and I suck and get permanent.
They were Nigerian properties, so community came and burnt
out. I don't know where you find it's a bit different on the Natal south coast.
Yeah. Oh, no, the prostitutes and the drug lords here, I live now.
Oh, really?
I had to put a dip in the sale price.
Just to move it?
Yeah.
What is that?
Yeah. It's hard to know what to do, isn't it? I mean, when I came to this country, I worked at Mogintween. It's a big AECI factory. I was there for 5 years. Days I was ZS5ZX, but I wouldn't want to go back to the coast anymore. Oh, really? Well, that
I go every time to year.
Yeah, if you've got mates down there, then it's okay.
I have a cousin down there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, if you've got friends and family, that's fine. But we really don't have. I mean, if we look hard enough, we'll find a friend, but not enough to justify.
Any trouble is about 5 or 6 years.
Yeah.
I'm going to treat you
a couple of guys from Dave in Ramsgate.
He gets up to London. On occasion.
Yeah, he regularly goes. Peter, ZS2ABF. But to get those guys to turn their beans inland.
All right, let's try and settle down. I don't know who's not here. Looks like there's some people not here yet. Anyway, we'll find out that shortly. Good morning, everyone, and nice to see you again. We've got a couple of hitches again, believe it or not. And the one hitch is the HF modem they hear. They arrived on Wednesday, but when they were put through a test during this week, since Wednesday, Anton found they are insensitive on the HF bands. So he is having a running battle with the supplier. So you have two options. You can either take it as it is, or we will forward you the new supply that will replace these from maybe another supplier. So these are the things that you must decide. If you take it, you can't change it. But if you don't take it today, and when we get the new ones, and Anton, I don't know how long that will take.
Yeah, so in fact, this is the second batch from a different supplier that has exactly the same problem. So it looks like wherever they're getting it from in China, the factory, has created this problem. So I've had a running battle with them at the moment, but it looks like they'll refund me and I'll send them back. But what I'm also trying to do is I'm still sitting with the previous batch, which I also haven't sent back yet. I've taken one apart, I'm trying to find out what the problem is. It looks like there's two soldering joints and a transistor which is defective. So I'm going to try and fix them for other purposes. So the other thing that I can offer is another product I've sourced. I've already placed an order on this product. I can't say how well it works because I've never used the product. So the option is that I'm going to source another supplier. They're probably going to supply me with new ones of these when they come eventually. Or I can offer you the other one which I've now just sourced. They're already on order. Price-wise, they're about the same price. I think there's maybe 80 rand difference between the two. The other one is a little bit smaller in physical size. But again, I can't tell you how well they work until that new product is here. I tested them and I know, okay. That's why I could have given you this, but I don't want to do it. I honestly feel that I rather need to send you the new dongles when the new product arrives. I'm very sorry about this. I really tried my best to sourcing a different supplier for the same product, but I'm having the same problem. So I'm really sorry about that. The stuff arrived on Wednesday, I tested them last night, and I've tested them on Thursday, and I'm not happy. So the VHF side works, VHF works, but the HF part doesn't work.
So if he was the supplier on the corner, you would have just given it to you and said, well, it's your intent if it doesn't work.
Yeah.
So thanks very much for being up front with us.
I feel bad about it because I think a lot of people are here to taste this and play with it and everything, but I have a problem.
We will just now, what we're going to do is we're going to start a session first, and then after the introductions by myself and by Nico, we will then hand out the rest of the stuff that you've ordered one by one, because it gets quite complicated with so many different variations that we have. It gets more complicated. You need to keep track on it on my spreadsheet when I get your... I hope I incorporated it correctly and I did bring the originals as well. But let's just ask the president of the SRL to welcome you and talk a little bit about SDR and HF noise.
Sort that a bit later. Sorry.
This is a cool game, that's
why. Good morning, all, and welcome to another workshop. Hans and I
and long discussions and long ideas, and will it work or will we just like and find something else? And it seems like it is an extreme successful run, especially in Cape Town. It was quite amazing to see the outcome and the interest, the absolute interest. I 2 weeks ago I had a group of individuals with a meeting and some youngsters, and I'm deviating slightly from the topic today, but it's absolutely fascinating stuff. When Rashi and I attended the IARU, and I will be talking about some feedback from the IARU Region 1 conference in October in Germany, Don Beattie, the IARU Region 1 president, did something totally different to the normal run-of-the-mill stuff for these conferences. He arranged for a workshop on the Wednesday evening. And the interesting thing is, you know, when after many of these subcommittee meetings, they go well into the night because time is of the essence, and believe me, they couldn't care what's on that agenda. If they can find 5 minutes or half an hour, whatever, to have to continue with their work, they do it. Amazingly, there was huge pressure on to make sure that there were no meetings, additional work group meetings on that Wednesday evening, and everybody attended Don's workshop. And the fascinating thing is Don put up a silhouette of a guy with a beard and a Morse code key. The fascinating thing is he started off, he said, "Ladies and gentlemen," he says, "I believe this is the image of amateur radio in the world." And if you talk to the youngsters of today, it is. And then he flipped his presentation, and he removed the individual and he left the Morse code key there. He says, "But my personal experience and feedback received in the last 2 years was that Morse code is by far more popular amongst the youth than what it was in the heydays when there was an absolute requirement to obtain a license." And that is fact. Now the reverse is also true. We are moving rapidly into the latest and greatest of technologies, and believe me, our working industry and some of this stuff is hair-raising. Believe me, there is no such thing as privacy anymore. It's as simple as that. Intelligence gathering has become a fine art to such an extent that it is, for the man in the street, luckily, they don't know. They sleep well at night. Okay. The interesting thing is that as the amateur fraternity in the world, the numbers are dwindling. And the only way forward is to introduce this to the younger generation. But now this morning I was on my way driving, I suddenly realized, I said, well, you know, this is the fourth workshop we've got. And look at the average age. And normally when I get, Queen Water, grab a seat. What I normally bump my head against is the older generation that says this new technology is no good for nobody. It's not good for human or animal consumption. Okay? And you guys prove the opposite to me. There's a definite interest in new technology. And the beauty about all this is that nobody can disagree with me when I say the old technology and the latest and the greatest dovetail second to none. It's as simple as that. Okay. So that's purely what my experience is, never mind the different opinions. So there's this doom and gloom picture being painted out there. But yet you install a different opinion and trust in my world in a way forward. And that's why we're here today. So we're talking about SDR and some HF noise issues that we've got. The big issue is in today's world is the growing problem of a rising RF noise floor being experienced and the impact on amateur radio services. It was a hair-raising experience at the IARU conference because you've got a team of absolute experts in industry in Europe that is members of this working group, and the stuff they talk about compared to and bring in line with what I experienced in South Africa. Guys, it's hair-raising stuff to see what is happening out there. So the committee C7 outcome is basically, after I had the opportunity to present a paper that we submitted to them. The long and the short is, and these guys have got wonderful ideas. The long and the short is the outcome is basically is to start a simple, cost-effective noise measuring campaign amongst everyone in Region 1. Now that does, that for the moment, you must remember we've got three regions. So if we start something in Region 1, we need to kind of get Region 2 and Region 3 to buy into it. So that is basically work in progress. Nevertheless, a paper that we've submitted on our project of noise floor measurement was very well received. And the ideas, they spontaneously, there was lots of ideas that came about. Big thing is this, we are way ahead, Hans, this is my take on it.
Judging from the meeting last week.
Yes, especially from the meeting. At this point in time, we are way ahead in moving forward, in getting in the necessary infrastructure in place, equipment, and our biggest thing is, and that you'll see at the outcome, or why we need to, there's one component missing that we need to put in place. We are way ahead at this point in time, and I think they're going to take pointers from ourselves. There's no two ways about it. Okay, our project, and with Anton's help, we've got a working model on the table. And the only other aspects that they discussed and that was basically under consideration was the methods of sampling, detectors and bandwidth, antennas and calibration. And I sat there and I was listening to these experts. And remember, they are experts in the field. That's what they do day in and day out. So, very professional, these folks, must say.
And they've got millions to their disposal.
And they've got millions, yes, yeah. Down south, we are way ahead at this point in time. So, for the moment, yeah, I took note of all those nice things, and to be scientifically correct, yeah, we will get there eventually, all right? But for now, what we've got on the table works, and we can move forward. That's the long and the short of the outcome. Nevertheless, our paper was well received, and as I said, there's work in the background happening. And from time to time, as these meetings happen, and we move slowly on, a step at a time, we will take a couple of steps at a time. We will keep you guys posted. The interesting thing is, Brendan, Echo India 6 India Zulu was took the responsibility to coordinate and chair the ad hoc working group. A part of his task is to pull in region, all the other regions as well. Okay. Now, just to touch on what was under discussion. Was basically, in addition to the current interference issues, we know about our solar panels and our LED lights and lots of stuff. Guys, slowly but surely, another monster has crept into our houses, into our offices, into our society, called wireless power transfer, WPT technology. Nico, what is that? It's simple. The latest and greatest is the old cell phone charger. It's a nice little flat thing, and you put your cell phone on it, and you walk away, and it charges by itself. Hey, that is technology. Wonderful stuff. All right, so it's nice, and the consumer, of course, out there absolutely loves this, second to none. Nevertheless, there's another monster behind this monster called electric vehicles. And the fascinating thing is that that Friday, after the conference ended the Thursday night with the dinner and the awards evening, we had the opportunity to visit the BMW factory in Germany, in Landshut. Now, what an eye-opener. Believe me, it's just, if I start talking about that, I will never stop. It's fascinating. But what was Nico's experience? We were walking as a group, and then the front lot started walking across the road in the factory, and we decided to do the same. Goodness gracious. Normally you can hear vehicles, one of these new high-tech battery vehicles approached us from the back. I didn't hear it. The next thing there was this hooter behind me. Believe me, I scraped myself now and I had a blood group. And when I looked around and I saw this vehicle, you know what? Battery vehicles, you can have it. Not in my day and age. But the long and the short is, by 2020, BMW will stop producing petrol and diesel vehicles. But that's 3 years down the line. In the meantime, our weird and wonderful monster has crept in there as well. Alright? Because that's what it's all about. They are talking about. Remember what you see on TV is the filling station being replaced with some funny thing with a lead to plug into your vehicle. No, that's all technology. The latest and greatest is basically is a primary coil 100%. In your garage. Okay? And the vehicle has got the secondary one. And you pull into your garage, walk away from your vehicle, and it automatically charges. Just as the old cell phone charger on a very smaller scale. Many other devices as well. So just look at some of these factors. Probably operating at 85 kilohertz. Alright? Up to 22 kilowatt per installation. 5 installations per hectare. Just imagine townhouses. Right? Charging up to 12 hours at a time. And there's the ugly component, the RF component. In this entire process, which is still undefined and not standardized. And you know what's the sad story? The sad story is there is no proper specifications in place yet. All right. I don't want to debate this. All I wanted to do is just to show you guys what is around the corner for us. Over and above, LED lights, solar panels. In Europe, they cry about these windmill farms. That there's a massive problem over there. Okay. So there you are. Just a bit of a introduction to what's lying ahead. And somebody said in that conference, this equals to the destruction of the spectrum as we know it today. Is he right? Is he wrong? Time will tell. Right, why the workshop? We've got some objectives for the workshop, is to develop a coordinated program and form a study group. We've got the program, that's simple as that. We've got the program, there we kind of lack at this point in time. The monitoring system, as far as I know, the hardware is in place, and then basically we need a steering committee. Now that's where I'm just going to leave it to Hans, I don't want to steal his thunder. In moving forward, we seriously need to start going. And the fascinating thing is, all over the world, it's always the amateur fraternity that takes the first step with all this latest and greatest of technology. Right, that's my story, and thank you for listening. Hans, all yours.
Thanks very much. Go. Well, just fast forward on the... How do you make that? On this whole story, let me just take you fast forward. There was a meeting of the EMC working group, which is equivalent to the C7 at the conference that Nico spoke about 2 weeks ago. Was it maybe a week ago? Tom goes too quickly. And concern was about these problems is that basically the regulations or the specification around this power transfer, WPT, is a function of CISPA. CISPA is the standards body that controls it. And they've had meetings, and some of the proposals made by the industry are too far-reaching in terms of the limitations of interference they can cause. In other words, the level of interference that they're allowed to have before they have to shut down. Or if you look at it this way, to say, well, what is the what is the absolute limit that they have to comply with? Because the problem is not the 85 kilohertz. The problem is the harmonics. And so you should be able to suppress harmonics if you have the proper design. But the industry has voted to make it very wide because obviously it reduces the cost of producing the equipment. And what the main concern is, and why they're raising, IOUs raising these issues so vocally, is that it looks like that people in Germany will support it. The wider limits, because they have at this stage, you know, there's a Volkswagen, there's a BMW, there's, you know, Audi, there's a lot of manufacturers, and so for the German government is under pressure from their industry to actually allow these limits to be very wide. The trouble is, we also have a vote at CISPA, at the CISPA conference, where these things get discussed and where the specifications can then get put up and then either get agreed or go voted down or told they have to go back and change them and make them sort of like more narrow. So our job now as the SAOL is to actually get the SABS TC73, which deals with EMC matters, to actually make sure that our delegate to the CISPA conference, the next one is in April, actually raises his voice and says that, hang on, these specs are no good. They, you know, you guys need to go back to the drawing board. Because we have a year or two to do that. So I've already asked the chairman of the working group that deals with that he must urgently convene a meeting so that we can talk about these issues and make sure it gets onto the agenda of the TC73 meeting, because those meetings only happen twice a year. And we need to make sure that TC73 and the SABS stands behind that process, and that the delegate, which is most probably, you see, we were fortunate, Eric Winter, a radio amateur in Cape Town, was for years South Africa's representative of CISPA, but he sadly passed away last year. So now it's somebody at SABS that may not have quite the understanding of the big issues that we're dealing with. So there's a lot of pressure that I'm currently putting onto the SABS and TC73 to start addressing and discussing these kind of things. As far as the HF monitor is concerned, and I don't want to take you through the whole reason why, because I think Nico has explained it pretty well, and very well, on why we need to be doing this. But we need a steering committee, because at the moment it's like ad hoc. It's me and Nico that talk and get on. On them to do all the work. We keep them occupied for weeknights at end, a couple of weeks at a time. And you know, we need to form a steering committee that can start formulating some of the stuff, that can make sure that, and we're talking at the moment, we have an offer of a server capacity, free of charge. But we need to supply a document. So that steering committee needs to sit down with Anton in the next few days. When I sit down, we often mostly do these things on Skype meetings at night, to actually say, well, this is the reason, that's what we want, that's how much we need, that's how we're going to do it. Because when you have the software and you have the dongle, hopefully the bench is going to work on HF properly, you will be able to, you know, to then upload that stuff automatically. So then we start developing a database of the kind of noise level. Now, what Nico said, that at the IOU they brought up a lot of issues about how you know, how complicated it is, and you must look at all these other kind of parameters. It's interesting that at the meeting, Brandon, that is the sort of their working group chairman, that has to facilitate that, he gave a discussion, he had a discussion on what he envisages. And I asked him a question. I said, what about the specification of antennas? How do we make sure that the antennas we're going to use all comply to the same kind of standard? How do we do this? How do we test them and all that kind of thing? And he was so adamant about it originally, and now he's turned around and said, well, let's forget about the antennas at this point in time. Let's get the system running. Let's get people start monitoring. Let's get as much data as we can. Because besides that, you may argue and saying, well, the noise floor went up by this much, or it went up by that much. The fact that we're really trying to do right now is to say it is going up, and we want to prove it is going up. And you can do that by comparing, if you have a long wire antenna that you're using, and you look at all the HF bands, and you have something different, it doesn't really matter, because what we see is on your data from today, in 3 months' time, we see that there is a gradual increase in the noise level. Now that may be because your neighbor has installed a lot of solar panels and lots of LED lights that were causing havoc. That of course would show that. But yours and yours and yours will also have gone up, but maybe we have different circumstances. So what we're trying to do at this stage is say, from today, 3 months from now, let's just see what happens. And because if it's a solar light issue, you'll find that it's fine during the day, and then at night it will go up. So, you know, you see the pattern. But at this stage, it's just important for us to collect that data. The next step would be, yes, to properly specify antenna gain, all those kind of things, and calibrate the antenna so that everybody uses the same. But that's a very big process. It needs a lot of complicated equipment to be able to do that. And it also means is we all need to start using the same type of antenna. And even then, it depends on the sensitivity of your dongle, depends on the amount of coax feed line that you run. So that's a very complicated issue, and we need to get a study group that looks at those issues, but that's long term. Short term is to get somebody, a couple of you together, that are prepared to work with us and do some of the thinking and some of the checking around what else is going on in the world, so you know that we have like a representative committee that can actually run this project, because you need to run this and also make sure that over time you sort of have consistency and continuity. So if you have a number of people involved, it's more likely that you have continuity than maybe Nick and I driving it. I may keel over tomorrow and he may decide to go and live in Hawaii, and then the project stops. So if you have a few more people, you find there's some continuity in there. So one of the objectives today is to find out, and I'll give it to after tea time to decide who's going to join that working group. Again, meetings are always on Skype. Very seldom we must probably get together after an event like this for an hour after the event is finished. But we don't necessarily meet face to face, because we find people just don't have the time to travel or want to travel. And yeah, Skype works very well if you have a good internet connection. If you have a lousy internet connection, Skype doesn't work. It runs over too many errors and too many noises. But you have a reasonable sort of either a fiber or an LTE connection to the internet, and Skype actually works very well. It's quite interesting. I made a recording of that EMC meeting, and there were 12 people all over the world, all over Europe. I was the only one that was in the dark south. And we never had a problem for the 2 hours that the meeting lasted. What I had a problem with is I just found that people in Europe become very wary. They take 10 minutes to agree on whether the agenda item 6 need to move to 3, and 3 needs to move to 6. That can take 10 minutes. But we have to model up with those kind of things. Maybe we're just a little faster than some people now. Yes, sir.
Hans, what sort of qualifications does somebody have to be able to contribute to your working group? I mean, presumably they have to know one end of a DB from another or something like that, you know.
I think the main qualification is enthusiasm. The drive to want it to happen. Because if you don't know something about the DB, or you know about the level, so many DBs, one of so many DBs, you'll soon learn that from interacting with your peers. So that's not this. It's always nice you have some technical people on there, but you also need people that drive enthusiasm, that go out and that become evangelists to encourage people. So I would say that the main qualification you need to have is enthusiasm. You must have a reasonable Skype connection, otherwise it's bad luck.
Does that include video?
No, we don't use video. Because we find that video, it takes a lot more bandwidth. So Skype for many years didn't allow video for more than one-to-one, and they do now, but it's not a good idea. So we never use video when we have meetings. You can, of course, collaborate files on Skype. A lot of people know how to do that. But while you're in the Skype discussion, you can actually upload something on Skype, and on the other side, the guys can download the data. That's not a big issue on Skype. That works quite well. But normally what we do is we distribute all the documentation before the time, so then the guys can look it up. And the beauty of Skype is you can let it run in the background, and you can still use your computer and look at any data or anything that's done. So that's what I think we need to look at. If we can, I see we're getting fancy here now. If we can, you see, he does that so you can't fall asleep, because then we can watch it. Everybody else will see you falling asleep. So basically, it's just think about it, talk about it yourself, and then after tea. And I look in the kitchen. I think tea break needs to come quite soon because it looks pretty good. Thanks, Annette. All right, so let's find out from Anton where we are.
Okay, just to let everybody know, you're live on the internet. You've got 89 viewers. And it looks like we might pick up. So wave to everybody. I think what we're going to try and do, I'm trying to establish what is the main interest. So let's concentrate on that. So what I've got here, and what we can concentrate on, is I've got Raspberry Pi, which has got the noise software on. I've got the automatic startup disk, which is a flash disk, which will start up with the noise monitoring software on it. I've also included in that same flash disk the satellite tracking software, G-Predict.
I mean, I can get mine to work
as well. Yes. G-Predict. I've got GQRX. X in there, there's like 3 or 4 SDR softwares on there. So you could use that for the whole session as well. So that's all Linux based. So what it will do, it will boot up in Ubuntu and so on. Then I've got another memory stick, and I think maybe what we should do is hand out the memory sticks now so that people that's got the laptops can boot up and follow us as we go. I've got another memory stick which is all the Microsoft stuff on. So basically all the tracking software there and all everything is on there. So what we're going to try and do is get through as much quick technical stuff, and then we can dig into actual physical trying stuff. So if you get stuck, I can help you and ask questions. We want to try and make it interactive. So I think what we should do now is maybe just hand out everything that's ordered. And I think we've agreed, everybody's made a decision on the SDRs. I'll keep it, and then I'll send them out when the new ones are off. Everybody agree with that? Okay. So let's do the rest at the moment. So what you'll get for those guys, it's all the Windows ones, and it's two memory sticks. The Windows one is not an auto boot one. It's just got the software on, so you need to install it in your Windows. But the Linux one is an auto boot one. You can even install Linux on it. This is Ubuntu 16.04, the version, the long-term support version. It actually works fine. I've got the newer one, the 1710, which is the latest Ubuntu. I don't know if you guys have seen the new Linux. It's really fantastic. I'm not finished with it yet. So in about a week's time, you'll have that one. It's available on the site as well, so you can purchase it on there. Hans, let's start with this.
Yeah, I think if you can start with, we just get you to come up and check on the list and you get your stuff quickly. Sorry for those that have to sit. Wait, the first one on my list is deck codes. So this is VUN if you'd like to come and get your stuff. And deck's got an HF dongle and a basic memory stick.
Is that the Windows or the...
No, HF dongle.
HF dongle.
Yeah,
okay,
so he doesn't get
that one.
And you don't want to take it, you wait
for
the system.
No.
So the memory stick is a basic memory stick.
Is that the Windows one or is it the Norton?
No, basic is, no, the Norton is the HF memory stick.
So this is the Windows one.
Yeah. This is the HF one, sorry. Leon van Breda. Now, weet ik what you look like.
I'm not family to the X-Men.
Yeah?
That's
got everything on it.
Yes. You'll see there's a direct email workshop, and all the applications is listed there.
Okay.
I'll give you a URL later on my website for all installation procedures as well.
Right. William's got the VHF dongle. The HF dongle we're not going to give you now. Memory stick, not memory sticks.
Oh. So this is an auto boot one. So you can just double check that you've got that's the HF noise one. Okay. And this one is the workshop one, which is just auto noise.
And by the way, thanks for those who joined MZSA. Your certificates and letters will be in the mail early next week. So that's all your stuff, eh? Alan Carson and Carl Leiser in Cape Town wants. Graham, you've got nothing. Sydney, and we're going to call Graham up as soon as we've done this, Graham. Sydney Friedman, you've got both dongles and both software.
Your
cell number. I've got your cell number, so that will be shipped to you.
Right,
then, Jerry Peterson. I didn't see him.
You can't listen.
I haven't seen him for quite a few years, and he said he was...
I can deliver it for him if you
want.
Well,
maybe you still come, let's see.
Okay.
Not just before you go, let's
see.
Then we've got email.
Email.
How do you call it?
Email.
Email.
You get the email, the French one, and then the Emilios, the Italian one.
Okay, you've got both dongles and memory stick. B, which is the VHF one.
Not the A?
No, the VHF one.
Not the HF.
B is basic. And which is the,
okay.
Not the HF one. You didn't order the HF one.
That's my mistake.
Well, you may be able to organize it with him if you want it. They'll
be available on the website as well afterwards.
Anyone's the basic memory stick.
Basic.
I've got all the SDR software, I've got all the tracking software. It's got seven apps on there, coming in our hand.
I thought it was only the noise one that was different to this one. No, so originally it was on the noise system, but on my website I've got a list of all the software. It was on the MZ website. Yeah, so there was space on the dongle,
so I thought let me add it, so you've got actually pre-installed applications at the same time.
No, I was just hoping that it was
Jerry Williams.
All the tracking stuff.
No, everything is there. Thank you.
He's got both uncles and both.
So I'm going to shift the number to you. I've got your number then.
Yeah.
Okay. So the moment they arrive, I'll give you a shift. And you, and only and which software?
Both.
So there's the HF one. This is the auto boot one. So you need to set your laptop for auto boot and then let it boot from this. And then you'll get the whole Linux environment.
Well, we
show you how it looks like just now. And this is the Windows.
Andrew Fraser.
How did you put the fruit in a closed tin?
Got no ways.
Sneaky.
HF dongle and both software.
Okay, so
it's only
I'm going to give you the HF.
Hey, it's just such a nice
one. Okay. And this is just the Windows software.
Pierre Smith, the HF dongle, which you of course have, and both software. Windows.
Clever,
right? HF memory stick, sorry.
The rest I've got.
I just want to remind you guys, when I get queries, they say, well, did you get my stuff? About two or three days after you submitted your stuff, on the MZSA website, if you look at the conference, there's a list of who we received from. So you can always check that yourself, that we haven't missed you, because it can happen. I can overlook it, and it also can end up in cyber space somewhere. Okay, right, that's it. What is your weather satellite?
Okay, so I wanted to do a weather satellite, but looking at the on the tracking software last night, the only one that we can pick up is NOAA 16 today, and NOAA 16 is disabled at the moment. So we've got no overhead weather satellite. So I'm really feeling bad about that, but it's out of my control. So what we can do is we can probably do some of the other ones, just showing how to track some of them. I did some pre-recording on doing the FunCube decoding, the telemetry decoding, so I'll show you how to do that.
What do you use this?
It's fine. I'm just going to check you. Sorry, I'm going to sit down so I can actually operate the software quite easily. But shout. Okay, so I've got a bit of a problem. I've got a very strong signal close by, so the ALC is is picking up, but what I probably can do, I can link remotely into my home, so hopefully there's not a lot of curing there, and we should be able to see what we can do. I'm looking at the satellite details today. I just want to show you this. So what I did is, the dongle, which has got this is Linux at the moment, but this software is also available on Windows, so you recognize most of the details here. But basically, this is gpredict, and for the guys that doesn't know it, it's pretty easy to operate. So basically what you do is you will select so you can create a module. Let me explain to you how this works. You see, I had for some reason I can't see both at the same time, so I'll try and show you. So you can go there, file, new module, and you can give us a thing, a module name. For instance, you're interested in weather satellites. So we'll just select weather. And then you get this list. So now what you can do is here you'll see there's different satellite subcategories.
You can use this good point.
Okay. So basically what we'll do is we'll select the subcategories that we're interested in, and I'm gonna select all and let's say new all.
This is
okay. Thanks. So there is the list of newer ones. Now for instance in this case, these ones is negative, it's non-active ones. And if we scroll down a bit. So what I'll do is you'll select these ones. And you'll say okay. Now you'll see we've got a new tab at the top and we've got the selected satellites of interest. Now if I want to know for the day, when will they come over? Pretty easy to do. You close it, open here. You'll go to this little tab here, Sky at a Glance, which is open now on the screen here. Okay. So basically, this tells us that we've got NOAA 19 right top of us at the moment. At, time is wrong, 8 o'clock, 8, 9, 10, what's the time now? Yeah, so this is UTC. It's UTC, so it's actually true. So what you then do is you will click on this thing here, and it will show you the actual time, and you can see when it's coming past and the angle of horizon. Now this is too low, we can't record. That's why there's no use. Normally you can start receiving them from about 7 to 10 degrees elevation, and you can pick them up. So what I'll do, I'll quickly go to the site which I've recorded this morning. So we'll click on this link here, and this is an automated system which you can also install. I've got the instructions on my website how to install this. Let me show you what you've got for this morning. So this was taken yesterday at 1555. For instance, you can't see. Sorry. This was taken yesterday, 1555. This is the southern part of South Africa. And look at this cyclone that's actually busy building up, which is quite interesting. You're asking why the funny colors? I'll show you now if we use the software and how to decode it. But basically, there's different patterns or filters you can apply to the photograph that's been downloaded. And this one specifically does coloring on the height of clouds. So if I remember correct, the green is either lower or higher, I'm not sure now. I think it's lower. No, it's actually otherwise. I think white is lower and green is higher clouds. So this specific pattern will give you that. So if you go back...
But aren't you looking from the top, so it should be the white.
Yeah, but these greens also, I'll show you now. If you look at this, we'll look at these other photos as well. They're all actually white, but this filter colors it in for you. So let me take this one, it's a normal one. It's quite a big photo. Quite a lot of resolution is actually zoomed in, so if you click on it, you can actually zoom into it quite a bit. But basically, there you can see now the green stuff that we saw was these clouds here, which were supplying the filter. But there's no filter on here at the moment, so that's purely as it is. So, you know, that's the type of stuff you can play around, and I'll show you how the software works. But basically, if you go to my site, let's go back here. And you scroll to the top, I've got all the audio files that was recorded. So you can download it and I'll apply it to the application that's on the memory stick. So if you look at the memory stick, there's a WX2 image to IMG, it's the application's name. And we'll start that application up quickly.
Oh, what's that URL for those?
My URL, it's this one here. There are 6alphainventory.digger.co.za. And then you'll get an index page, and one of the links there says NOAA Weather Satellite. And then you'll get to this page. Okay, so. So I'm going to come back to this one just now, maybe after tea or whatever. I wanted to actually show you this software that converts this. I've got it installed on this laptop, so we'll jump to that. But let's just get back to the satellite tracking part. So if I go back here. So basically what you will see is a pattern. I've got video recordings on our website as well. I can actually take you there and we can play a video. I've done, who's been in the last workshop, the previous one? Okay, so maybe I must play. Because then I played a video actually showing you how this looks like and then how we decode it. Let me just show you quickly.
You know, most of us battle with one laptop. And someone uses three. No, how many more machines? So the damage you get done. Yeah. I have.
go to this, this is my site where I've got all instructions to install the software. Okay, let's keep that this. This is the installation procedure for the Linux startup. Name stick I've just showed you. So if you scroll down, this is the HF stuff. Basically, I describe here the software that's automatically downloaded, and how to install it, how to configure it if you want to set it up yourself. How it works. Maybe I can explain to you how it works as well. So we've got the RTLF dongle, which then takes scheduled recordings, newer satellite audio recordings, onto disk. So basically, we use a utility called predict, which is a command line utility, which I schedule to define all overhead passes for the day, and then save that, and then automatically starts recording the audio during that period and stops. That's all it does. Then I've got another utility that converts it to another file format, which is this WX2 image utility that converts it into a satellite image. The scheduler is basically the only thing that's required for the recordings, and that's done with the predict software. That's the principle how it works. This is the steps how to install it, so on and so on. Let's not get to the video. This is where the links are to the site, some sample videos. That's the antenna. I don't know if you can see it at the back. It's the same antenna we've got on the outside here. This one here is a 2 meter one, but that's just a 136 megahertz antenna. So that's the one I recommend. It works pretty good. I've got a lot of feedback from it. People are very happy with it. You can see you need to do a lot of stuff to make it work. I almost recommend, if you're not a Linux person, I do have the SD cards pre-configured for your Raspberry Pi. And it's nice for Raspberry Pi, you just stuck it in, it can sit in the corner and it gets you all your satellite recordings for you. So, or if you're a Linux fundi, then here's the steps to do it.
You have one of those Raspberry Pi's made SD here?
Yes. Might have. I'll have to go and check quick. Might have. I'll check afterwards. Yeah. Okay. This is on my YouTube channel. You just look quickly on YouTube. So basically, I want to show you how this software looks like as well.
Just use the standing in front of the screen.
With the web SDR.
Just use the
Wetter Satelliten einzufangen. Das ist mir zwar gelungen. Jetzt kommt auch bald wieder eine angeflogen.
But this is taken from my web SDR. For you guys who doesn't know it. So my web SDR is exposing this on the internet. So what this German guy has done, he went to my web SDR in South Africa and he did the recording from in Germany using my web SDR in South Africa. So he's basically explaining how he got it working. He looked at the and there you will see the photo start appearing on the actual software. WX2 image is the software. I know if guys that's got their laptops here that wants to need my help. This is how the pattern looks like. When you look at the screen, has gone away. But you'll see lines coming down, and it's quite a wide bandwidth. The problem is if you use a handhold or something, the bandwidth is wider than 25. So if you've got the new ones 12.5, then it's even worse. So you need to actually need a little bit wider bandwidth. So why the USB memory sticks work so well, the SDR sticks, so because you can open up the bandwidth quite nicely. What's also nice is the output Doppler is if you make the bandwidth even a little bit wider, you don't have to adjust it so often. You can maybe adjust it a few times, and it will stay on frequency all the time. That is where the satellite is. A pity we didn't have one that came over, one that's active. But if you look on the memory stick, I've put one file on there. So if you install the software, there's one file, audio file on there, you can load it and you'll see the picture already. So that's, I think, should we try something else once?
Mm-hmm.
Go back. So normally, if you run the software, you will now see those lines coming in. You will slowly just take your up or down frequency, or you can just drag it a little bit. You keep your center on the middle line all the time. Record it. Why I say record it? Why not do it real time? Especially in the beginning when you're learning, it's quite nice to have a recording which you can take into the application, play around with the filters, play, you know, what you want to do. If you're real time and you've got a problem, it's lost, it's past, it's gone. So this way you can play with a software. There's little filters, remember the different color filters for the clouds, infrared filters for night. You can play with all that. After tea, I'll actually start the application up for you and I'll show you all the filters as well. Basically, that's what's going to happen. I think that's it on the weather satellite. Any questions around it? Is that clear?
So which are the main ones? The VHF?
Yeah, so they're 136 megahertz, the newer ones. I mean, there's the Meteor ones as well. I think they're 1.7 gigs. So you need a smaller disk for them. And they're geostationary. So they actually got much higher quality pictures. I think for experimental purposes, this quality of these pictures is not bad that we get. You'll see there's even a mode on the software to make it even higher resolution, but it's very massive images, and then the browsers are getting slow. So if you want to use for normal internet use, the default configuration is almost the best to use. Otherwise, for guys with low bandwidth, they're struggling to look at the bigger pictures. It's a pity we've got these strong signals locally. Otherwise, I could now have picked up maybe some CW from some of the satellites. Because this way you're not going to pick up. But what we'll do, let me see if I can go to the web SDR. It will probably solve a problem. Hopefully I don't have strong signals at my house. So again, we go to the root URL, this one. And then you'll see this one here is the satellite monitoring web SDR. And we will try frequently. Let me see what satellites above us, so maybe we can actually see something. So maybe we can try it, see if we can get a little bit of a recording real time. So what time is that then? We might have
11:33.
Elevation starts at 1911. Yeah, so 11:30, just before 11:30, we need to switch over and we can see if I can show you a real time recording of that.
Is that now?
New one 19.
Okay.
I hope it's active. I'm not sure. Somebody know? Okay, so what we'll do is when it comes over, we will see if we can report that one.
What image of satellites are there? There's some that come over.
So this is the view of the satellites I've selected. If somebody else knows of a satellite we can maybe decode now, we could try.
What have you selected then?
So let's just add some. So that's the weather one. So there's actually one above us. Quite nice. AO51. That's, I don't know if beacon is coming. We can check. Does somebody know what the frequency is? AO51.
Isn't it show on the software?
No. AO51. Oh, you know what? I've actually got it on my WebSDR. You search 51. You won't find it. I've got this list up here, which is a lot of satellites. So if you're not sure what the beacon is, you can just click on here. So we'll just search for AO51. And you see it somewhere. What is the frequency? I must get my screen to the mirror. So if I look at
435, 300.
Sorry, say again. 435, 300.
300.
Okay, so let's try that. Let me see what this is. So let's go down here. 435, 300.
Satellite is that?
AO51. Is it active? I don't think so. I'm not sure.
AO51. 150.
Something here. What's this? Let's keep the volume up. You got an external.
Yeah.
There is something there. Normally you could see the satellites coming over pretty clear. So we'll get some better speaker on. So we'll see if I can get the something there. Yeah?
Supposed to be more than 4.7 because most of those are vertical and negative than 4.5. 4.7.
It's got the 4.7 band as well. Something here. See a lot of CW beacons. And this is not a little line until you zoom in, you can see the CW quite clearly. Oh yeah, IAS, just by the way, sends APRS on this frequency, 145.825. I'll show you how the modem software looks like, how to decode this. That's quite pretty easy to do. What I'll do is I'm actually going to show you this on Windows. So if you're using the same software on the internet or using your dongle to record, then I'll show you how to decode the APRS.
Turn the volume down because we can't hear you.
Okay, that's fine. I'm gonna just turn it down here.
I'm using that.
See if I've got it not installed. I don't have it installed.
What's it? You got MP4 or what?
What?
That's. What is it?
That's the bigger version of your blue dongle.
The bigger one?
Yeah.
The size is impressive, it's so small.
It's just the repackaging of the blue one. There's some filters and additional battery. If you go onto your dongle, the HF workshop, this is the applications that you'll find there. So the one I'm going to show you how to decode now is called sound modem. These two, you'll see this one here, it's HS sound modem. This one is if you do decoding 9
because you keep on staying in front of your screen. Yeah.
Okay, so this one is for 9600 baud rate upwards. We'll use this one, and for the slower ones, you'll use this application here. It's just called sound modem. So I'm just going to show you how this works. And if you want to, I'll also. Okay, that's fine. Okay, so. Maybe a concept I must explain to you is how do we forward the sound to this application? By not using the microphone, speaker out and microphone back, a loopback, whatever. You can actually tell the application to forward the audio, and we call it the virtual audio cable. Now if you look into your application directory, there's one called virtual audio cable, there it is. So if you install this application, if you install this virtual audio cable, this one, I'll show you now what will happen. If you go to your sound section and you say recording, you'll see there's a new application or section in there called cable output. Now you've got it in the recording and in your playback. So once you've installed this virtual audio cable, you select this and you disable your microphone. So how do you do it? You right click on here. Oops, wrong mouse. And you say disable. And then on the virtual cable, you say enable. Okay, so default. So this one I'm going to disable. So now what we do is if we've got the sound playing on the SDR, which is this one, oops, reset. So hopefully we can hear some sound. So you can hear some sound there. So how do we get this sound to go to? So you'll go to this and you say playback, and then you say this cable. Now what's going to happen? So now you can't hear the sound anymore. Okay, so what it's doing now is it's sending it to the virtual cable. Now if we go back, the sound modem application, which was this one, we go to settings, devices, and now you'll see we've also got, sorry, not output input, virtual audio cable, and we'll select that. Now you see we've actually got the audio coming in, right? So now depending on the satellite's modem decoding that you need to do, you will have to select the speed here. Now if you look at the speed of the International Space Station, that will be the first one, the 1200. So what you will do then is you'll select 1200 there. What this application also allows you to do is to decode two speeds at the same time. So you're not always sure what this is. You hear something, you want to decode it, you can set it up. You'll see there's two monitor screens. So you can let the one decode maybe at 1200 and the other one at maybe 24, whatever the case may be. So you're lucky in the one because you're not sure what speed it is. Because sometimes you hear stuff, you don't know which satellite it is, you actually send it through, and you'll see there's like white lines coming here. And all you do is you drag this across the section of where the signal will be. So for International Space Station, what I'll do is I'll quickly switch to the APRS beacon because that's also 1200 port, and we'll decode it quickly. I'll show you.
But satellites, most of them are either 1200 or 96.
Yes. So in most cases, you will only use this. Right? And you'll see this list don't have the 96 in it. Remember I said the high-speed modem? So for the 96, you'll use the high-speed modem. For the low-speed ones, you'll use this application. The one's got HS in front of sound modem, and the other one hasn't. So that's how you distinguish between the two. You'll see the other list starts at 96 upwards. Okay, so let's try and decode this quickly. So I can show you actually how it works. So if I go to 144.800, which is this one, and I select FM. So if we're lucky, we will see a burst of signal coming in, and then we'll have to minimize this so we can see both when there is a signal and when we're actually decoding. So we can see the two at the same time. We'll make it even smaller. So what will happen, once there's a signal coming in here, you will immediately see the pattern in this noise floor here. And then if it's not perfect the first time, you just move this up and down so it's across the center of it. There was a signal now. Now you can see, I missed it now. Maybe the level is a bit low. Let's just increase the audio level a bit. Oh, is it there? Okay, so let me just increase the audio level a bit. There was quite a nice strong one. Maybe it's decoded it. Let's just see. Okay, so what will happen, if it decodes it, you will see the actual decoded message coming in here. I was hoping it's decoded it now.
But Anton, is that the only way to connect your audio to your decoder? Is internally via the virtual loop?
The thing is, you can obviously loop it externally if you want to, but every time you convert digital sound to analog and back to digital again, you lose and you introduce noise. And you lose some quality.
Yeah, but I thought the decoder would have that built in already.
No, unfortunately, Microsoft is not that friendly when it comes to trying to forward audio from one application to the other one. So the only way you can really make it work properly is with the virtual audio cable. So what you do is you send the one, and you'll see in the sound modem application, remember settings, device, you'll see you've got this virtual audio cable. Normally you'll have microphone. If I enable microphone, you'll have microphone as well.
Mm.
And you select the virtual audio cable. Because if you enable microphone as well, you introduce noise on top of the signal as well. Mm. So make sure that microphone is off. So that's the options you will use. I wish somebody will send some IPRS so we can see some signal. but basically, that's hopefully we can get one more. I think this thing is normally we need to sit around about here. If we're lucky, next burst we might get a nice output there. But basically, that's what you'll do, depending on the speed of the satellite.
There is a nice one.
It's pretty accurate. Sure, why we might get that one at the 411 satellite. Quickly see if we can go to 1,800 here. FM. So we can zoom in 2 or 3 times. So we can see the signal. 1,400. 1,800. And just increase the audio level a bit. So we do that. The signal is strong enough. I think it's a bit too strong for me. What you could do as well, when you use your SDR software, is normally, and most of them have got audio recording. Now, especially in the beginning, if you want to decode the software, let it record it. Because what you can do then, take the audio file, play it back until you've got the settings correct on this. Normally, the default settings for the DCD threshold, these settings by default normally works as it is. You can play around a little bit with the audio level, which is I found. This looks a bit too wide for me. I think it's a bit too strong. But basically what this allowed, the decoded one. See, there was a signal came in, and there was one decoded. And as simple as that. It's not difficult to do. You get your SDR software up, do the virtual audio cable, start up the sound modem, tune to the frequency. Maybe you'll have to play around with this a little bit for the few messages you're getting. And then there you are. Now what I want to do is I want to show you the FunCube satellite. FunCube satellite at the moment, the one that's active, is FunCube 1. Its telemetry is sending continuously. So that one is quite nice. You can see the stream coming in all the time, and I'll show you a video about it. Now I'll show you the software. The FunCube software that they've written, see there's another message coming. The FunCube software that they've written actually automatically uploads the data to their site. And there's an index page which will show you which amateurs has actually sent data, and it's like a competition in the world who can send the most data. So that's a lot of fun to do that as well. So what you can do with the FunCube is you'll see there's a continuous stream, that's at 96 board. So you can use either this other modem software that I showed you to decode it, but their software is quite nice because what it does, it actually decodes the message and show you the battery voltages, solar panels, and so on and so on.
But you know, interesting, I tried to do that now and I couldn't link the signals.
I actually got it working, was it Wednesday night? I uploaded some data, I'll show you how it looks like.
But it used to be continuous.
It's always continuous, yeah. They've got different power, so what they did is they run the beacon at different powers when the batteries were still live. At the moment it only works during daytime, so at night it's dead. Batteries is gone.
Mm.
So you can only sort of, I would say from 8, 9 o'clock in the morning, if you've got a pass during the day till maybe for 5 in the afternoon and it will work quite nice. It's a pretty strong stall. The one that I picked up on Wednesday night was very, very strong.
Yeah, Stellenbosch is one that is not continuous.
Yeah, the ZAQ.
Yes.
Yeah, that's just like ZAQ, you use this modem and software I've just showed you. Exactly 1,200 port.
That's what I want to do.
Yeah. I've tried it this week, I couldn't pick it up. ZAQ, I've tried, I couldn't.
Yeah, but the best prices are those that's close to Cape Town, for they make sure that they monitor the Cape Town, then they switch the damn beacon off till they hit Cape Town. They do that sometimes.
I'm just trying to think, what's it called, dashboard?
Someone passes that favors Cape Town will be best for the code.
Sometimes the passage is better, yeah, then it's worse for Cape Town, so don't. I mean, depends where the satellite is. Sometimes I get right across you, and then it's worse for Cape Town if it even goes north.
No, they don't always switch it on when it's bad.
Oh,
them.
I see.
That's the problem.
It's a bad control.
I've got a YouTube video where I've decoded it. It's on YouTube, my YouTube channel. You can go and have a look at it. I just want to quickly find this. For some reason, I can't remember what the application's name is. FunCube dashboard. Okay, so basically, sorry, I didn't have the FunCube software on the memory stick. That's maybe something I should do for the next one.
But isn't it? For, I think it was on your list. Yeah.
Mm. No, I don't think so.
It is a FunCube.
But you can download it from this site. Sorry about that, that's maybe an oversight on my starting up and seeing it. Yeah. So this is basically the software that will come up. Now at the moment it's not doing anything. Again, we need to set the capture point and the settings to maybe I'll tell you these details. You see the second tab, whereas I'm not gonna go in there because my passwords and stuff is indexed. So what you do is you go and register on the FunCube website, on the warehouse website, and they will send you a password, the passkey. In that warehouse thing, you'll put the passkey in, and what this application will do, once you decode the satellite details, it will actually automatically send it up to this site. Let me just see. Capture. Alright. So basically what you will see is you will see.
I got stuck last night.
Yeah. At night it won't work because
batteries
are gone. So you have to do it during the day. This is what you will see basically. Once you, let me see if I can get a video on FunCube.
But on the site, you can see the status of the battery.
Yeah, so basically, is that the friendly name for FunCube? Are you saying it's your company name?
Yeah, right.
Okay. So basically, you will see the stream coming down. It's like a white line, and every now and then, get like a square empty block. So I've got it sent to the thingy now. Let's just send it to the sound thingy.
When you recorded, you're building RAW, R-A-W.
Sorry, say again?
Do you record it in RAW for the software gives you the opportunity to take both? And
I record anything, I think, whatever my recording software is, any normally WAV or RAW, whatever. The problem is with RAW is not all players play RAW. Then you have to use a utility called SOX to convert it to a WAV file. So if you want to play it back, it's probably better to save it in a WAV file or MP3.
Yeah, I normally do it WAV, but yeah. I was wondering if you will use that on the decoder.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so this guy's not really showing us much, but I was hoping he would actually show the SDR signal. Make this quieter. Let's see if we can get another one. Yeah, this one looks like this guy is showing the actual signal on the. So this is basically what you see. So this is like a white stripe. If you zoom in, if you zoom in even more, and you will see once it starts decoding, this data will automatically start updating. Battery voltage, solar panel voltage. That's all. You can hear a sound there. Very quiet.
You want to turn it up?
Make it louder. Just want the guys so you can recognize it. That's how it sounds. But
are you going to go down the FM or what? So what's the mode did you go down?
96.
No, FM, SSB.
Oh, upper side band.
Upper side.
Yeah, so you have to be on upper side band for this. It's normally at 145.935 MHz. Around about there. Just search for it. When it comes up, you'll see the signal slowly coming up. You see the guy has now drifted off the Doppler. He has to move it, which he hasn't done. He has to move it up, otherwise he'll lose it, lose the data. But basically that's how it sounds. And then it will send it up to the website. Now, oh yeah, another thing, fitter. I'm going to show you this fitter thing. This is quite interesting. I think I've got my fitter messages in my application. That I've decoded this week. No, it actually loses it. But basically, if you've got an event like this, and I actually did email him and I was hoping we could send a fitter message for today, which would say welcome to the workshop, South Africa, and so on and so on. So what it does is like a Twitter message, which gets sent up to the satellite, and they send it for the whole day, all the Twitter messages. Now they call it fitter. Now you'll see the fitters coming in here. So if you've got an event with the schools or something, it's quite nice to have a specific message for the school or whatever, which is quite nice. You just need to speak to the UK guys that's managing it. I was trying to get hold of them because their email seems to be changed, but hopefully next time we'll have success. So what will happen is also you will see this filter messages coming into the screen. On their website they've got analysis software, so you can look at the battery voltages and things like that. See quickly if I can show you. So I want to show you what that, where you have the data gets uploaded. Uploading the data, which is ground station, data warehouse. So what's nice about this is you get recognized for the work that you're doing for them, and I think they've got a list of all this one. Yeah, so if you look here, there's a list of all amateurs in the world and who submitted data, and there's some real-time analysis of the data that you've submitted, and so quite a lot of fun you can have. At least your name gets submitted, and maybe you can up some South African guys that submitted there and get higher than them, which is a lot of fun.
It's one of the amateur satellites that's got the most data, continuous data, over a time period.
Yes, that's got the world record of the most data recorded ever. And the reason for it is because it's got a continuous stream. So all the time you've got data. If you look at the normal one CubeSat, I think that's a 3U. They've got a lot of solar power. They've got a very efficient transmitter. So they could actually transmit all the time. The problem is why people are not transmitting all the time is you've only got so much power on a satellite, so they only transmit maybe every 1 minute or 30 seconds or whatever the case. So you've only got a small burst of data, because that's the only power they have on a satellite. So because they've got a 3U satellite with a very high efficient transmitter and a lot of solar power, they can actually transmit continuously, which is quite nice.
But are they running on the 300 watts now, a milliwatt? They used to save the beacon on the 40 milliwatt.
Yeah, so what they used to do is they used to run high power during the week and low power at night on the beacon. And the reason for that is for schools. They got all the schools involved in the UK, so they can decode the telemetry and get involved, get the Twitter messages and so on and so on. The Twitter messages. So I think that was the purpose, is to get school involvement and